The Common Reader, Volume 1, by Virginia Woolf. Read by Joan Walker for Ukemi Audiobooks. To Lytton Strachey. Some of these papers appeared originally in the Times Literary Supplement, The Athenaeum, The Nation and Athenaeum, The New Statesman, The London Mercury, The Dial, New York, The New Republic, New York, and I have to thank the editors for allowing me to reprint them here. Some are based upon articles written for various newspapers, while others appear now for the first time. The Common Reader. There is a sentence in Dr. Johnson's Life of Gray, which might well be written up in all those rooms too humble to be called libraries, yet full of books, where the pursuit of reading is carried on by private people. I rejoice to concur with the Common Reader, for by the common sense of readers, uncorrupted by literary prejudices, after all the refinements of subtlety and the dogmatism of learning, must be finally decided all claim to poetical honours. It defines their qualities, it dignifies their aims, it bestows upon a pursuit which devours a great deal of time and is yet apt to leave behind it nothing very substantial, the sanction of the great man's approval. The Common Reader, as Dr. Johnson implies, differs from the critic and the scholar. He is worse educated, and nature has not gifted him so generously. He reads for his own pleasure, rather than to impart knowledge or correct the opinions of others. Above all, he is guided by an instinct to create for himself, out of whatever odds and ends he can come by, some kind of whole. A portrait of a man, a sketch of an age, a theory of the art of writing. He never ceases, as he reads, to run up some rickety and ramshackle fabric which shall give him the temporary satisfaction of looking sufficiently like the real object to allow of affection, laughter, and argument. Hasty, inaccurate, and superficial, snatching now this poem, now that scrap of old furniture, without caring where he finds it or of what nature it may be so long as it serves his purpose and rounds his structure, his deficiencies as a critic are too obvious to be pointed out. But if he has, as Dr. Johnson maintained, some say in the final distribution of poetical honours, then perhaps it may be worthwhile to write down a few of the ideas and opinions which, insignificant in themselves, yet contribute to so mighty a result. The Pastons and Chaucer. The tower of Caister Castle still rises 90 feet into the air, and the arch still stands from which Sir John Fastolf's barges sailed out to fetch stone for the building of the great castle. But now jackdaws nest on the tower, and of the castle, which once covered 6 acres of ground, only ruined walls remain, pierced by loopholes and surmounted by battlements, though there are neither arches within nor cannon without. As for the 7 religious men, and the 7 poor folk who should at this very moment be praying for the souls of Sir John and his parents, there is no sign of them nor sound of their prayers. The place is a ruin. Antiquaries speculate and differ. Not so very far off lie more ruins, the ruins of Bromholm Priory, where John Paston was buried naturally enough, since his house was only a mile or so away, lying on low ground by the sea, 20 miles north of Norwich. The coast is dangerous and the land, even in our time, inaccessible. Nevertheless, the little bit of wood at Bromholm, the fragment of the true cross, brought pilgrims incessantly to the priory and sent them away with eyes opened and limbs straightened. But some of them, with their newly opened eyes, saw a sight which shocked them. The grave of John Paston in Bromholm Priory without a tombstone. The news spread over the countryside. The Pastons had fallen. They that had been so powerful could no longer afford a stone to put above John Paston's head. Margaret, his widow, could not pay her debts. The eldest son, Sir John, wasted his property upon women and tournaments, while the younger, John also, though a man of greater parts, thought more of his hawks than of his harvests. The pilgrims, of course, were liars, as people whose eyes have just been opened by a piece of the true cross have every right to be. But their news, nonetheless, was welcome. The Pastons had risen in the world. People said even that they had been bondmen not so very long ago. At any rate, men still living could remember John's grandfather, Clement, tilling his own land, a hard-working peasant. And William, Clement's son, becoming a judge and buying land. And John, William's son, marrying well and buying more land, and quite lately inheriting the vast new castle at Caister, and all Sir John's lands in Norfolk and Suffolk. People said that he had forged the old knight's will. What wonder, then, that he lacked a tombstone? But if we consider the character of Sir John Paston, John's eldest son, and his upbringing and his surroundings, and the relations between himself and his father, as the family letters reveal them, we shall see how difficult it was, and how likely to be neglected, this business of making his father's tombstone. For let us imagine, in the most desolate part of England known to us at the present moment, a raw, new-built house, without telephone, bathroom or drains, armchairs or newspapers, and one shelf perhaps of books unwieldy to hold, expensive to come by. The windows look out upon a few cultivated fields and a dozen hovels, and beyond them there is the sea on one side, on the other a vast fen. A single road crosses the fen, but there is a hole in it, which, one of the farmhands reports, is big enough to swallow a carriage. And the man adds, Tom Topcroft, the mad bricklayer, has broken loose again and ranges the country half naked, threatening to kill anyone who approaches him. That is what they talk about at dinner in the desolate house, while the chimney smokes horribly and the draught lifts the carpets on the floor. Orders are given to lock all gates at sunset, and when the long dismal evening has worn itself away, simply and solemnly, girt about with dangers as they are, these isolated men and women fall upon their knees in prayer. In the 15th century, however, the wild landscape was broken suddenly and very strangely by vast piles of brand new masonry. There rose out of the sandhills and heaths of the Norfolk coast a huge bulk of stone, like a modern hotel in a watering place. But there was no parade, no lodging houses, and no pier at Yarmouth then, and this gigantic building on the outskirts of the town was built to house one solitary old gentleman without any children, Sir John Fastolf, who had fought at Agincourt and acquired great wealth. He had fought at Agincourt and got but little reward. No one took his advice. Men spoke ill of him behind his back. He was well aware of it. His temper was none the sweeter for that. He was a hot-tempered old man, powerful, embittered by a sense of grievance. But whether on the battlefield or at court, he thought perpetually of Caister, and how, when his duties allowed, he would settle down on his father's land and live in a great house of his own building. The gigantic structure of Caister Castle was in progress not so many miles away when the little Pastons were children. John Paston, the father, had charge of some part of the business, and the children listened, as soon as they could listen at all, to talk of stone and building, of barges gone to London and not yet returned, of the 26 private chambers, of the hall and chapel, of foundations, measurements, and rascally workpeople. Later, in 1454, when the work was finished and Sir John had come to spend his last years at Caister, they may have seen for themselves the mass of treasure that was stored there, the tables laden with gold and silver plate, the wardrobes stuffed with gowns of velvet and satin and cloth of gold, with hoods and tippets and beaver hats and leather jackets and velvet doublets, and how the very pillowcases on the beds were of green and purple silk. There were tapestries everywhere. The beds were laid and the bedrooms hung with tapestries representing sieges, hunting and hawking, men fishing, archers shooting, ladies playing on their harps, dallying with ducks, or a giant bearing the leg of a bear in his hand. Such were the fruits of a well-spent life. To buy land, to build great houses, to stuff these houses full of gold and silver plate, though the privy might well be in the bedroom, was the proper aim of mankind. Mr. and Mrs. Paston spent the greater part of their energies in the same exhausting occupation. For since the passion to acquire was universal, one could never rest secure in one's possessions for long. The outlying parts of one's property were in perpetual jeopardy. The Duke of Norfolk might covet this manor, the Duke of Suffolk that. Some trumped-up excuse, as, for instance, that the Pastons were bondmen, gave them the right to seize the house and batter down the lodgers in the owner's absence. And how could the owner of Paston and Mortby and Drayton and Gresham be in 5 or 6 places at once, especially now that Caister Castle was his, and he must be in London trying to get his rights recognised by the king? The king was mad too, they said, did not know his own child, they said. Or the king was in flight, or there was civil war in the land. Norfolk was always the most distressed of counties, and its country gentlemen the most quarrelsome of mankind. Indeed, had Mrs. Paston chosen, she could have told her children how, when she was a young woman, 1,000 men with bows and arrows and pans of burning fire had marched upon Gresham and broken the gates and mined the walls of the room where she sat alone. But much worse things than that had happened to women. She neither bewailed her lot nor thought herself a heroine. The long, long letters which she wrote so laboriously in her clear, cramped hand to her husband, who was, as usual, away, make no mention of herself. The sheep had wasted the hay. Haydon's and Tuddenham's men were out. A dyke had been broken and a bullock stolen. They needed treacle badly, and really she must have stuff for a dress. But Mrs. Paston did not talk about herself. Thus, the little Pastons would see their mother writing or dictating page after page, hour after hour, long, long letters, but to interrupt a parent who writes so laboriously of such important matters would have been a sin. The prattle of children, the lore of the nursery or schoolroom, did not find its way into these elaborate communications. For the most part, her letters are the letters of an honest bailiff to his master, explaining, asking advice, giving news, rendering accounts. There was robbery and manslaughter. It was difficult to get in the rents. Richard Cowell had gathered but little money. And what with one thing and another, Margaret had not had time to make out, as she should have done, the inventory of the goods which her husband desired. Well might old Agnes, surveying her son's affairs rather grimly from a distance, counsel him to contrive it so that ye may have less to do in the world, your father said, in little business lieth much rest. This world is but a thoroughfare and full of woe, and when we depart therefrom, right naught bear with us but our good deeds and ill. The thought of death would thus come upon them in a clap. Old Fastolf, cumbered with wealth and property, had his vision at the end of hell fire and shrieked aloud to his executors to distribute alms and see that prayers were said in perpetuum so that his soul might escape the agonies of purgatory. William Paston, the judge, was urgent too that the monks of Norwich should be retained to pray for his soul forever. The soul was no wisp of air, but a solid body capable of eternal suffering, and the fire that destroyed it was as fierce as any that burnt on mortal grates. Forever there would be monks, and the town of Norwich, and forever the chapel of Our Lady in the town of Norwich. There was something matter-of-fact, positive and enduring in their conception both of life and death. With the plan of existence so vigorously marked out, children, of course, were well beaten, and boys and girls taught to know their places. They must acquire land, but they must obey their parents. A mother would clout her daughter's head 3 times a week and break the skin if she did not conform to the laws of behaviour. Agnes Paston, a lady of birth and breeding, beat her daughter, Elizabeth. Margaret Paston, a softer-hearted woman, turned her daughter out of the house for loving the honest bailiff, Richard Cowell. Brothers would not suffer their sisters to marry beneath them and sell candle and mustard in Framlingham. The fathers quarrelled with the sons, and the mothers, fonder of their boys than of their girls, yet bound by all law and custom to obey their husbands, were torn asunder in their efforts to keep the peace. With all her pains, Margaret failed to prevent rash acts on the part of her eldest son, John, or the bitter words with which his father denounced him. "He was a drone among bees," the father burst out, "which labour for gathering honey in the fields, and the drone doth naught but taketh his part of it." He treated his parents with insolence, and yet was fit for no charge of responsibility abroad. But the quarrel was ended very shortly by the death, the 22nd of May 1466, of John Paston, the father, in London. The body was brought down to Bromholme to be buried. 12 poor men trudged all the way bearing torches beside it. Arms were distributed, masses and dirges were said, bells were rung, great quantities of fowls, sheep, pigs, eggs, bread and cream were devoured, ale and wine drunk, and candles burnt. Two panes were taken from the church windows to let out the reek of the torches. Black cloth was distributed, and a light set burning on the grave. But John Paston, the heir, delayed to make his father's tombstone. He was a young man, something over 24 years of age. The discipline and the drudgery of a country life bored him. When he ran away from home, it was, apparently, to attempt to enter the king's household. Whatever doubts, indeed, might be cast by their enemies on the blood of the Pastons, Sir John was unmistakably a gentleman. He had inherited his lands. The honey was his that the bees had gathered with so much labour. He had the instincts of enjoyment rather than of acquisition, and with his mother's parsimony was strangely mixed something of his father's ambition. Yet his own indolent and luxurious temperament took the edge from both. He was attractive to women, liked society and tournaments and court life and making bets and sometimes even reading books. And so life, now that John Paston was buried, started afresh upon rather a different foundation. There could be little outward change, indeed. Margaret still ruled the house. She still ordered the lives of the younger children as she had ordered the lives of the elder. The boys still needed to be beaten into book learning by their tutors. The girls still loved the wrong men and must be married to the right. Rents had to be collected. The interminable lawsuit for the Fastolf property dragged on. Battles were fought. The roses of York and Lancaster alternately faded and flourished. Norfolk was full of poor people seeking redress for their grievances, and Margaret worked for her son, as she had worked for her husband, with this significant change only, that now, instead of confiding in her husband, she took the advice of her priest. But inwardly there was a change. It seems at last as if the hard outer shell had served its purpose, and something sensitive, appreciative, and pleasure-loving had formed within. At any rate, Sir John, writing to his brother John at home, strayed sometimes from the business on hand to crack a joke, to send a piece of gossip, or to instruct him knowingly and even subtly upon the conduct of a love affair. "Be as lowly to the mother as ye list, but to the maid not too lowly, nor that ye be too glad to speed, nor too sorry to fail, and I shall always be your herald both here if she come hither, and at home when I come home, which I hope hastily within 11 days at the furthest." And then a hawk was to be bought, a hat or new silk laces sent down to John in Norfolk, prosecuting his suit, flying his hawks, and attending with considerable energy and not too nice a sense of honesty to the affairs of the Paston estates. The lights had long since burnt out on John Paston's grave, but still Sir John delayed. No tomb replaced them. He had his excuses, what with the business of the lawsuit and his duties at court and the disturbance of the civil wars, his time was occupied and his money spent. But perhaps something strange had happened to Sir John himself, and not only to Sir John dallying in London, but to his sister Marjorie falling in love with the bailiff, and to Walter making Latin verses at Eton, and to John flying his hawks at Paston. Life was a little more various in its pleasures. They were not quite so sure as the elder generation had been of the rights of man and of the dues of God, of the horrors of death and of the importance of tombstones. Poor Margaret Paston scented the change and sought uneasily with the pen which had marched so stiffly through so many pages to lay bare the root of her troubles. It was not that the lawsuit saddened her. She was ready to defend Caister with her own hands if need be, though I cannot well guide nor rule soldiers. But there was something wrong with the family since the death of her husband and master. Perhaps her son had failed in his service to God. He had been too proud or too lavish in his expenditure. Or perhaps he had shown too little mercy to the poor. Whatever the fault might be, she only knew that Sir John spent twice as much money as his father for less result, that they could scarcely pay their debts without selling land, wood, or household stuff. It is a death to me to think of it, while every day people spoke ill of them in the country because they left John Paston to lie without a tombstone. The money that might have bought it, or more land and more goblets and more tapestry, was spent by Sir John on clocks and trinkets, and upon paying a clerk to copy out treatises upon knighthood and other such stuff. There they stood at Paston, 11 volumes with the poems of Lydgate and Chaucer among them, diffusing a strange air into the gaunt, comfortless house, inviting men to indolence and vanity, distracting their thoughts from business, and leading them not only to neglect their own profit, but to think lightly of the sacred dues of the dead. For sometimes, instead of riding off on his horse to inspect his crops or bargain with his tenants, Sir John would sit, in broad daylight, reading. There, on the hard chair in the comfortless room with the wind lifting the carpet and the smoke stinging his eyes, he would sit reading Chaucer, wasting his time, dreaming, or what strange intoxication was it that he drew from books? Life was rough, cheerless, and disappointing. A whole year of days would pass fruitlessly in dreary business, like dashes of rain on the window pane. There was no reason in it, as there had been for his father, no imperative need to establish a family and acquire an important position for children who were not born or, if born, had no right to bear their father's name. But Lydgate's poems or Chaucer's, like a mirror in which figures move brightly, silently and compactly, showed him the very skies, fields and people whom he knew, but rounded and complete. Instead of waiting listlessly for news from London, or piecing out from his mother's gossip some country tragedy of love and jealousy, here, in a few pages, the whole story was laid before him. And then, as he rode or sat at table, he would remember some description or saying which bore upon the present moment, and fixed it, or some string of words would charm him, and putting aside the pressure of the moment, he would hasten home to sit in his chair and learn the end of the story. To learn the end of the story. Chaucer can still make us wish to do that. He has preeminently that storyteller's gift, which is almost the rarest gift among writers at the present day. Nothing happens to us as it did to our ancestors. Events are seldom important. If we recount them, we do not really believe in them. We have perhaps things of greater interest to say, and for these reasons natural storytellers like Mr. Garnett, whom we must distinguish from self-conscious storytellers like Mr. Masefield, have become rare. For the storyteller, besides his indescribable zest for facts, must tell his story craftily, without undue stress or excitement, or we shall swallow it whole and jumble the parts together. He must let us stop, give us time to think, and look about us, yet always be persuading us to move on. Chaucer was helped to this to some extent by the time of his birth, and in addition he had another advantage over the moderns which will never come the way of English poets again. England was an unspoilt country. His eyes rested on a virgin land, all unbroken grass and wood, except for the small towns and an occasional castle in the building. No villa roofs peered through Kentish treetops, no factory chimney smoked on the hillside. The state of the country, considering how poets go to nature, how they use her for their images and their contrasts, even when they do not describe her directly, is a matter of some importance. Her cultivation, or her savagery, influences the poet far more profoundly than the prose writer. To the modern poet, with Birmingham, Manchester and London the size they are, the country is the sanctuary of moral excellence, in contrast with the town which is the sink of vice. It is a retreat, the haunt of modesty and virtue, where men go to hide and moralise. There is something morbid, as if shrinking from human contact, in the nature worship of Wordsworth, still more in the microscopic devotion which Tennyson lavished upon the petals of roses and the buds of lime trees. But these were great poets. In their hands the country was no mere jeweller's shop or museum of curious objects to be described, even more curiously, in words. Poets of smaller gift, since the view is so much spoilt, and the garden or the meadow must replace the barren heath and the precipitous mountainside, are now confined to little landscapes, to birds' nests, to acorns with every wrinkle drawn to the life. The wider landscape is lost. But to Chaucer, the country was too large and too wild to be altogether agreeable. He turned instinctively, as if he had painful experience of their nature, from tempests and rocks to the bright May Day and the jocund landscape, from the harsh and mysterious to the gay and definite. Without possessing a tithe of the virtuosity in word painting which is the modern inheritance, he could give, in a few words or even when we come to look, without a single word of direct description, the sense of the open air. And see the fresher flores, how they springer. That is enough. Nature, uncompromising, untamed, was no looking glass for happy faces or confessor of unhappy souls. She was herself, sometimes therefore disagreeable enough and plain, but always in Chaucer's pages with the hardness and the freshness of an actual presence. Soon, however, we notice something of greater importance than the gay and picturesque appearance of the medieval world, the solidity which plumps it out, the conviction which animates the characters. There is immense variety in the Canterbury Tales, and yet, persisting underneath, one consistent type. Chaucer has his world, he has his young men, he has his young women. If one met them straying in Shakespeare's world, one would know them to be Chaucer's, not Shakespeare's. He wants to describe a girl, and this is what she looks like. Full samely her wimple pinched was, her nose trittese, her eye and grey as glass, her mouth full small, and thereto soft and red. But sickly she had a fair forehead. It was almost a span abroad, a trow, for hardily, she was nat under grower. Then he goes on to develop her. She was a girl, a virgin, cold in her virginity. I am thou woost yet of thy company, a maid and love hunting and venery, and for to walken in the wooders wilder, and nochter to been a wife and be with childer. Next he bethinks him how discreet she was in answering alway, and though she had been as wise as Pallas, no counterfeited terms had a she to seem wise, but after her degree she spake, and alla her word as more and lesser, sounding in virtue and in gentilesser. Each of these quotations, in fact, comes from a different tale, but they are parts, one feels, of the same personage, whom he had in mind, perhaps unconsciously, when he thought of a young girl, and for this reason, as she goes in and out of the Canterbury Tales, bearing different names, she has a stability which is only to be found where the poet has made up his mind, about young women, of course, but also about the world they live in, its end, its nature, and his own craft and technique, so that his mind is free to apply its force fully to its object. It does not occur to him that his Griselda might be improved or altered. There is no blur about her, no hesitation. She proves nothing. She is content to be herself. Upon her, therefore, the mind can rest with that unconscious ease which allows it, from hints and suggestions, to endow her with many more qualities than are actually referred to. Such is the power of conviction, a rare gift, a gift shared in our day by Joseph Conrad in his earlier novels, and a gift of supreme importance, for upon it the whole weight of the building depends. Once believe in Chaucer's young men and women, and we have no need of preaching or protest. We know what he finds good, what evil. The less said the better. Let him get on with his story, paint knights and squires, good women and bad, cooks, shipmen, priests, and we will supply the landscape, give his society its belief, its standing towards life and death, and make of the journey to Canterbury a spiritual pilgrimage. This simple faithfulness to his own conceptions was easier then than now, in one respect at least, for Chaucer could write frankly where we must either say nothing or say it slyly. He could sound every note in the language instead of finding a great many of the best gone dumb from disuse, and thus, when struck by daring fingers, giving off a loud, discordant jangle out of keeping with the rest. Much of Chaucer, a few lines perhaps in each of the tales, is improper and gives us, as we read it, the strange sensation of being naked to the air after being muffled in old clothing. And as a certain kind of humour depends upon being able to speak without self-consciousness of the parts and functions of the body, so with the advent of decency, literature lost the use of one of its limbs. It lost its power to create the wife of Bath, Juliet's nurse, and their recognisable, though already colourless relation, Moll Flanders. Sterne, from fear of coarseness, is forced into indecency. He must be witty, not humorous. He must hint instead of speaking outright. Nor can we believe, with Mr. Joyce's Ulysses before us, that laughter of the old kind will ever be heard again. But Lord Christ, when that it remembereth me, upon my youth and on my aeolity, it tickleth me about mine heart arota, until this day it doth mine heart abota, that I have had my world as in my time. The sound of that old woman's voice is still, but there is another and more important reason for the surprising brightness, the still effective merriment of the Canterbury Tales. Chaucer was a poet, but he never flinched from the life that was being lived at the moment before his eyes. A farmyard, with its straw, its dung, its cocks and its hens, is not, we have come to think, a poetic subject. Poets seem either to rule out the farmyard entirely, or to require that it shall be a farmyard in Thessaly and its pigs of mythological origin. But Chaucer says outright, "Three large sows had a she, and no more. Three kine, and eke a sheep that hicked a mala." Or again, "A yard she had her, enclosed all about, with stickers and a drier ditch without." He is unabashed and unafraid. He will always get close up to his object, an old man's chin. "With thicker bristles of his beard unsofter, like to the skin of houndfish, sharp as briar." Or an old man's neck. "The slacker skin about his necker shaketh while that he sang." And he will tell you what his characters wore, how they looked, what they ate and drank, as if poetry could handle the common facts of this very moment of Tuesday, the 16th day of April, 1387, without dirtying her hands. If he withdraws to the time of the Greeks or the Romans, it is only that his story leads him there. He has no desire to wrap himself round in antiquity, to take refuge in age, or to shirk the associations of common grocer's English. Therefore, when we say that we know the end of the journey, it is hard to quote the particular lines from which we take our knowledge. Chaucer fixed his eyes upon the road before him, not upon the world to come. He was little given to abstract contemplation. He deprecated with peculiar archness any competition with the scholars and divines. "The answer of this I letter to divinus, but well I woot that in this world grey pinus. What is this world? What asketh men to have? Now with his love, now in the colder grave, alone, withouten any company. O cruel goddess that governor this world with binding of your word eterna, and written in the table of Athamount, your parliament and your eterna grant. What is mankind a more unto yow holder than is the sheeper that rouketh in the fold? Questions press upon him. He asks them, but he is too true a poet to answer them. He leaves them unsolved, uncramped by the solution of the moment, and thus fresh for the generations that come after him. In his life, too, it would be impossible to write him down a man of this party or of that, a democrat or an aristocrat. He was a staunch churchman, but he laughed at priests. He was an able public servant and a courtier, but his views upon sexual morality were extremely lax. He sympathized with poverty, but did nothing to improve the lot of the poor. It is safe to say that not a single law has been framed or one stone set upon another because of anything that Chaucer said or wrote. And yet, as we read him, we are absorbing morality at every pore. For among writers there are two kinds. There are the priests, who take you by the hand and lead you straight up to the mystery. There are the laymen, who embed their doctrines in flesh and blood and make a complete model of the world without excluding the bad or laying stress upon the good. Wordsworth, Coleridge and Shelley are among the priests. They give us text after text, to be hung upon the wall, saying after saying to be laid upon the heart, like an amulet against disaster. Farewell, farewell, the heart that lives alone. He prayeth best that loveth best all things both great and small. Such lines of exhortation and command spring to memory instantly. But Chaucer lets us go our ways doing the ordinary things with the ordinary people. His morality lies in the way men and women behave to each other. We see them eating, drinking, laughing, and making love, and come to feel without a word being said what their standards are, and so are steeped through and through with their morality. There can be no more forcible preaching than this, where all actions and passions are represented, and instead of being solemnly exhorted, we are left to stray and stare and make out a meaning for ourselves. It is the morality of ordinary intercourse, the morality of the novel, which parents and librarians rightly judge to be far more persuasive than the morality of poetry. And so when we shut Chaucer, we feel that without a word being said, the criticism is complete. What we are saying, thinking, reading, doing has been commented upon. Nor are we left, merely with the sense, powerful though that is, of having been in good company and got used to the ways of good society. For as we have jogged through the real, the unadorned countryside, with first one good fellow cracking his joke or singing his song, and then another, we know that though this world resembles, it is not, in fact, our daily world. It is the world of poetry. Everything happens here more quickly and more intensely, and with better order than in life or in prose. There is a formal, elevated dullness which is part of the incantation of poetry. There are lines speaking half a second in advance what we were about to say, as if we read our thoughts before words cumbered them, and lines which we go back to read again with that heightened quality, that enchantment which keeps them glittering in the mind long afterwards. And the whole is held in its place, and its variety and divagations ordered by the power which is among the most impressive of all, the shaping power, the architect's power. It is the peculiarity of Chaucer, however, that though we feel at once this quickening, this enchantment, we cannot prove it by quotation. From most poets, quotation is easy and obvious. Some metaphor suddenly flowers, some passage breaks off from the rest. But Chaucer is very equal, very even-paced, very unmetaphorical. If we take six or seven lines in the hope that the quality will be contained in them, it has escaped. My lord, ye woot that in my father's place ye did me strip out of my povera weeder, and richly me clad know your grace, to yow brochter I knocked ellas out of dread, but faith and nakedness and maidenhead. In its place, that seemed not only memorable and moving, but fit to set beside striking beauties. Cut out and taken separately, it appears ordinary and quiet. Chaucer, it seems, has some art by which the most ordinary words and the simplest feelings, when laid side by side, make each other shine. When separated, lose their lustre. Thus, the pleasure he gives us is different from the pleasure that other poets give us, because it is more closely connected with what we have ourselves felt or observed. Eating, drinking, and fine weather, the May, cocks and hens, millers, old peasant women, flowers, there is a special stimulus in seeing all these common things so arranged that they affect us as poetry affects us, and are yet bright, sober, precise as we see them out of doors. There is a pungency in this unfigurative language, a stately and memorable beauty in the undraped sentences which follow each other like women so slightly veiled that you see the lines of their bodies as they go. And she set down her water-pot anon beside the threshold in an ox's stall. And then, as the procession takes its way, out from behind peeps the face of Chaucer, in league with all foxes, donkeys, and hens, to mock the pomps and ceremonies of life. Witty, intellectual, French, at the same time based upon a broad bottom of English humour. So Sir John read his Chaucer in the comfortless room, with the wind blowing and the smoke stinging, and left his father's tombstone unmade. But no book, no tomb, had power to hold him long. He was one of those ambiguous characters who haunt the boundary line where one age merges in another and are not able to inhabit either. At one moment, he was all for buying books cheap. Next, he was off to France and told his mother, "My mind is now not most upon books." In his own house, where his mother Margaret was perpetually making out inventories or confiding in Glois, the priest, he had no peace or comfort. There was always reason on her side. She was a brave woman for whose sake one must put up with the priest's insolence and choke down one's rage when the grumbling broke into open abuse. "And thou proud priest," and "thou proud squire," were bandied angrily about the room. All this, with the discomforts of life and the weakness of his own character, drove him to loiter in pleasanter places, to put off coming, to put off writing, to put off year after year the making of his father's tombstone. Yet John Paston had now lain for 12 years under the bare ground. The prior of Bromholm sent word that the grave cloth was in tatters, and he had tried to patch it himself. Worse still, for a proud woman like Margaret Paston, the country people murmured at the Pastons' lack of piety, and other families, she heard, of no greater standing than theirs, spent money in pious restoration in the very church where her husband lay unremembered. At last, turning from tournaments and Chaucer and Mistress Anne Holt, Sir John bethought him of a piece of cloth of gold, which had been used to cover his father's hearse, and might now be sold to defray the expenses of his tomb. Margaret had it in safe keeping. She had hoarded it and cared for it, and spent 20 marks on its repair. She grudged it, but there was no help for it. She sent it him, still distrusting his intentions or his power, to put them into effect. "If you sell it to any other use," she wrote, "by my troth, I shall never trust you while I live." But this final act, like so many that Sir John had undertaken in the course of his life, was left undone. A dispute with the Duke of Suffolk in the year 1479 made it necessary for him to visit London in spite of the epidemic of sickness that was abroad, and there in dirty lodgings alone, busy to the end with quarrels, clamorous to the end for money, Sir John died and was buried at Whitefriars in London. He left a natural daughter. He left a considerable number of books, but his father's tomb was still unmade. The 4 thick volumes of the Paston letters, however, swallow up this frustrated man as the sea absorbs a raindrop. For, like all collections of letters, they seem to hint that we need not care overmuch for the fortunes of individuals. The family will go on, whether Sir John lives or dies. It is their method to heap up, in mounds of insignificant and often dismal dust, the innumerable trivialities of daily life as it grinds itself out year after year. And then suddenly they blaze up. The day shines out, complete, alive, before our eyes. It is early morning, and strange men have been whispering among the women as they milk. It is evening, and there in the churchyard, Warne's wife bursts out against old Agnes Paston. All the devils of hell draw her soul to hell. Now it is the autumn in Norfolk, and Cecily Dawn comes whining to Sir John for clothing. Moreover, sir, liketh it your mastership to understand that winter and cold weather draweth nigh, and I have few clothes but of your gift. There is the ancient day spread out before us, hour by hour. But in all this there is no writing for writing's sake, no use of the pen to convey pleasure or amusement or any of the million shades of endearment and intimacy which have filled so many English letters since. Only occasionally, under stress of anger for the most part, does Margaret Paston quicken into some shrewd saw or solemn curse. Men cut large thongs here out of other men's leather. We beat the bushes and other men have the birds. Haste rueth, which is to my heart a very spear. That is her eloquence, and that her anguish. Her sons, it is true, bend their pens more easily to their will. They jest rather stiffly. They hint rather clumsily. They make a little scene like a rough puppet show of the old priest's anger and give a phrase or two directly as they were spoken in person. But when Chaucer lived, he must have heard this very language, matter-of-fact, unmetaphorical, far better fitted for narrative than for analysis, capable of religious solemnity or of broad humour, but very stiff material to put on the lips of men and women accosting each other face to face. In short, it is easy to see, from the Paston letters, why Chaucer wrote not Lear or Romeo and Juliet, but the Canterbury Tales. Sir John was buried, and John the younger brother succeeded in his turn. The Paston letters go on. Life at Paston continues much the same as before. Over it all broods a sense of discomfort and nakedness, of unwashed limbs thrust into splendid clothing, of tapestry blowing on the draughty walls, of the bedroom with its privy, of winds sweeping straight over land unmitigated by hedge or town, of Caister Castle covering with solid stone 6 acres of ground, and of the plain-faced Pastons indefatigably accumulating wealth, treading out the roads of Norfolk, and persisting with an obstinate courage which does them infinite credit in furnishing the bareness of England. On Not Knowing Greek. For it is vain and foolish to talk of knowing Greek, since in our ignorance we should be at the bottom of any class of schoolboys, since we do not know how the words sounded, or where precisely we ought to laugh, or how the actors acted, and between this foreign people and ourselves there is not only difference of race and tongue, but a tremendous breach of tradition. All the more strange, then, is it that we should wish to know Greek, try to know Greek, feel forever drawn back to Greek, and be forever making up some notion of the meaning of Greek, though from what incongruous odds and ends, with what slight resemblance to the real meaning of Greek, who shall say? It is obvious in the first place that Greek literature is the impersonal literature. Those few hundred years that separate John Paston from Plato, Norwich from Athens, make a chasm which the vast tide of European chatter can never succeed in crossing. When we read Chaucer, we are floated up to him insensibly on the current of our ancestors' lives. And later, as records increase and memories lengthen, there is scarcely a figure which has not its nimbus of association, its life and letters, its wife and family, its house, its character, its happy or dismal catastrophe. But the Greeks remain in a fastness of their own. Fate has been kind there too. She has preserved them from vulgarity. Euripides was eaten by dogs, Aeschylus killed by a stone, Sappho leapt from a cliff. We know no more of them than that. We have their poetry, and that is all. But that is not, and perhaps never can be, wholly true. Pick up any play by Sophocles, read. Son of him who led our hosts at Troy of old, son of Agamemnon. And at once the mind begins to fashion itself surroundings. It makes some background, even of the most provisional sort, for Sophocles. It imagines some village in a remote part of the country, near the sea. Even nowadays, such villages are to be found in the wilder parts of England, and as we enter them, we can scarcely help feeling that here, in this cluster of cottages, cut off from rail or city, are all the elements of a perfect existence. Here is the rectory, here the manor house, the farm and the cottages, the church for worship, the club for meeting, the cricket field for play. Here life is simply sorted out into its main elements. Each man and woman has his work. Each works for the health or happiness of others. And here, in this little community, characters become part of the common stock. The eccentricities of the clergyman are known. The great lady's defects of temper. The blacksmith's feud with the milkman and the loves and matings of the boys and girls. Here, life has cut the same grooves for centuries. Customs have arisen. Legends have attached themselves to hilltops and solitary trees, and the village has its history, its festivals, and its rivalries. It is the climate that is impossible. If we try to think of Sophocles here, we must annihilate the smoke and the damp and the thick, wet mists. We must sharpen the lines of the hills. We must imagine a beauty of stone and earth, rather than of woods and greenery. With warmth, and sunshine and months of brilliant fine weather, life, of course, is instantly changed. It is transacted out of doors, with the result, known to all who visit Italy, that small incidents are debated in the street, not in the sitting room, and become dramatic. Make people voluble, inspire in them that sneering, laughing nimbleness of wit and tongue peculiar to the southern races, which has nothing in common with the slow reserve, the low half-tones, the brooding introspective melancholy of people accustomed to live more than half the year indoors. That is the quality that first strikes us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.